Good morning. It is my great pleasure to give a lecture this morning. The picture you're seeing here is the city of Taipei. The first Asian science camp was held there. It's not a beautiful city, but it's an interesting, fun city. Air is somewhat polluted. This is Taipei 101, 500 meters tall. Well, today I will be talking about sustainable transformation of human society. As the chairman mentioned, this year there will be a very interesting meeting called COP21. Before we lead into that, in September 25, United Nations will have a Sustainable Development Summit, and there, Sustainable Development Goals write-up will be agreed upon. And yesterday I got an email and said the 170 countries engaged in that Sustainable Development Goal write-up already agreed. So things are moving better than what I expected. Well, here, COP21, a last chance for mankind. It is the last chance for mankind if we want to keep the temperature rise from Industrial Revolution to 2 degrees centigrade. I'm quite sure if we fail to come up some agreement at the end of the year, 2 degrees centigrade will not be able to be held. And that will have a very important consequences, as I will describe later. But this COP21 is really moving with a great momentum. Many of you probably remember COP15. 80 countries came and didn't come with any agreement. Major polluters didn't agree to sign. But this time it's different. 190 countries will all come, and major polluters already agree to have a deep decarbonization process going on. If you pay attention to it, the day before yesterday, Obama suggested a cut of carbon dioxide emission in their power sector. That generated about one-third of CO2. He said the carbon dioxide emission will be cut by 32% by 2030 in compared to 2005. That's a big leap forward. Last year, when Obama was in China, he agreed with Xi Jinping and said China will top the carbon dioxide emission by 2030, then bring it down. But things are moving even faster there, mainly because of the air pollution problem. Anyway, this is really a very important meeting, and we cannot fail. Fortunately, things are moving relatively well. So from my point of view, what should that meeting accomplish? Or what is at stake? So first of all, that meeting, one should have a binding global climate agreement that commit to the 2 degrees centigrade limit that was from the pre-industrial revolution up to 2 degrees centigrade. We have to make commitment. Making that commitment verbally is easy, but in order to accomplish that, then one has to do this. It's a clear and concrete pathway toward zero emission by 2070. Actually, by 2050, emission has to go down to 20% of what we are doing, because we accumulated so much carbon dioxide, and if you put up a carbon dioxide today, it will last for next 80 years, it will not disappear. So trend will continue. So it is really very important to start to have a deep decarbonization. 3 years ago, after Rio Plus 20 meeting, Ban Ki-moon organized two things. One is to organize science committee help coming up with a sustainable development goal. Another thing he did, he asked Jeffrey Sachs in Columbia University to come up with a committee, Sustainable Development Solution Network. and that network worked so hard. They asked every country to come up with a concrete reduction plan. So what we really need to see is a clear and concrete pathway toward zero emission by 2070. And many countries already proposed how are they going to do it. But it's important to implement it. The third thing I mentioned here, $100 billion a year to help developing countries transfer from developed country to developing country. That has not been agreed upon for quite a long time. But this year, it's gaining lots of momentum. I remember in February meeting in India, at the Sustainable Development Summit, already more than $60 billion committed. And so from 2020, $100 billion will transfer from developed country to developing country. That probably is an easier part of the problem. $100 billion is a large amount of money for all of us. But that's only 0.1% of global economic activities. Those are up to $100 trillion. And you look at the defense budget globally, it's also several trillion dollars. So $100 billion is really a peanut, very small amount for human activities. And that probably will come through. And the last important thing is achieve equity and eliminate indifference. It's interesting, we talk about disparity between rich and poor and sustainable development goal, trying to pull the poor people out from the poverty, hunger, but never touch upon how about those people accumulated so much wealth. If those people still keep on getting lots of return for the capital gain, I do not believe that we can bring up the poor people, hungry people upward. So we need to achieve equity and eliminate indifference. Those are, I believe, what needed to be done. And there's a good chance we'll come up with something, some agreement, and we have to see to it, it to be implemented. There are still lots of problems. If you look at the Sustainable Development Goal, 17 items and 169 checkpoints, and how can we achieve Sustainable Development Goal, there you will not understand what do we mean by sustainable development. We talk about enough energy, clean energy for all, enough food for all, very idealistic, but didn't touch upon enough energy. I mean 2 kilowatt or 10 kilowatt, and what kind of lifestyle, and how can we reduce the disparity between rich and poor. Regardless, we are making very important step during this year. And part of the reason, as I was saying, we did see lots of problems. Chairman said, Thailand is suffering from the drought. You turned on TV yesterday, Myanmar, it's a big flood. You go to America, California is a drought that is about so-called 100-year drought. While Texas is worried about you are going to have problem with drought, then it's flooded. India is a heat wave going through, and climate change at the present time is already not very ideal. Now, I'll trace time back from Murayama-san's lecture. Murayama-san did trace back to 13.8 billion years ago after the Big Bang. And he said, scientists can use accelerator, create the dense matter, trace back to 10 to the minus 10 seconds after the Big Bang. It takes more than 9 billion years before solar system was formed. And after the formation of solar system, we did see creation life. That was about 1 billion years after the solar system was formed. And then with the relation between sun and the surface of the earth, life beam on the surface of the earth. And took 4.5 billion years, we come to this stage. I said I continue with Muramasa's history, but what I'm going to talk about is really a tiny blip of time, not even 100 million part of the history of the universe. Our ancestor, so-called Homo sapiens, appeared about 2 million years ago, and then agriculture started about 10,000 years ago in many parts of the world. But because population was rather small, agriculture did affect the living environment, ecosystems, but not very important. But drastic change did occur about 200, 300 years ago. That was because of the advancement of science and technology and because of the Industrial Revolution. You see the picture, that is the painting done 300 years ago by a famous artist in Taiwan. That's the wedding ceremony of Aboriginal tribe in Taiwan. Is that wonderful? Bride and bridegroom was carried by four people in wonderful wedding ceremony. But what I want to point out is that everything you see, the housing, clothing, or what they are eating, they were eating, all came from sunshine, from biomass. But after the Industrial Revolution, the invention of steam engine, we started to demand lots of energy, and we have lots of energy buried underground in the form of fossil fuel. So from that time on, we started to dig out lots of things from underground and transform it into steel, cement, and burn the fossil fuel, and human society become prosperous. Material good is abundant, and society developed. Of course, that is because of the abundant energy and also advanced technology. So if you look at the energy usage during the last 150, 160 years, starting from 1800, and you see at that time most of the energy came from biomass, came from sunshine, and then coal started to be burned. And when I was born in 1936, that was after commercial aviation, but before TV time. I remember in Taiwan, first time I saw TV, and the program often shown head chop off because cameraman still didn't do well. So say somebody speaking and there's no head. That was the starting of the TV time. But of course, most of you are born maybe somewhere right here. By that time, all the energy we are using is, most of the energy we are using is fossil fuel. And it's interesting, you look at the burning of the coal. Coal, carbon to hydrogen ratio is over 1:1. Coal is not pure carbon. Coal, carbon to hydrogen is about 1:1. You look at the petroleum, 1:2. And natural gas, you look at the methane, it's carbon to hydrogen, it's 1:4. The single type of chemical reaction, combustion of fossil fuel, produce all the energy need. So you can see that the human society really started to use lots of energy and burn it up. Now I want to squeeze the time. This time frame is 150, 160 years. Now I want to squeeze it in terms of about thousands of years, and you see what happened. That's the population of 2000 BC and going up suddenly. And actually, around the last 200 years, population exploded. When we started the last century, population was 1.5 billion people. The end of the century went up to 6 billion people. That was the population the end of the century. Now we shot up to 7.2 billion, actually, today. And UN reported it's 7.4 billion people. and projecting the population will go up to through the roof, 9.7 billion people by 2050. Population really going up very quickly. And oh, I think we all contributed, right? So many of us are here. We're all part of this. In 1950, when the population went up to 2.5 billion people, the scientists said the Earth can support about 2.5 billion comfortably. It's 1950. And then the population keep on going up. So when you go up higher, the non-renewable resource will be depleted, and we'll see the starvation and serious worldwide environmental damage will take place. And then go up to 7.4, 9.7 by 2050. The question of human survival will be really serious. It's interesting, when you look at the population, FAO, or the United Nations, said by 2050, we need to have twice as much food. So we should work hard. The scientists always say, yes, that's a good challenge. We can do it. We can do it. Increase the food production by factor two. On the other hand, people work on the ecology will say, wait a minute, with all the extreme weather events, food production will go down by a factor two by 2050. So we need a factor two higher or a factor two lower. And that is a big challenge, big dilemma, if we really allow population to go up like that. In addition to the population, what we've seen is the consumption. Consumption. Population went up, consumption also increases. At the start of the last century, Henry Ford tried to make automobile mass produced, and then many high-tech products are mass produced, and Asia contributed enormously on this production process, started with Japan, Korea, Taiwan, other parts of the world, the Asia, China is now producing most of it, and everybody consuming it. In the beginning, family consumption, you have a family unit, you have a TV, washing machine, now you have iPod, iPad, and you name it. Everything, is everybody is consuming, and Earth is finite. With the population going up, consumption going up, what is the consequences? The consequences are the great acceleration of human impact. So here, I'm showing social economic trend. You look at the large dams and usage of water, telecommunication, transportation. That line is 1950. So over the last 60 years, everything showed up. Primary energy use, fertilizer consumption, you can see it. Everything's really going up. And if you look at the Earth system trend, carbon dioxide concentration is going up, nitrous oxide, surface temperature going up, shrimp aquaculture, marine fish capture, tropical forest loss. Still going up very quickly. So we are really changing the Earth system, social system, very, very quickly. And today, I have to say, we really are overloading the Earth. We are overloading the Earth. So when somebody said, we in the developed country try to help developing country, I said, nonsense. We are overdeveloped. Many countries are overdeveloped. And the overdeveloped country will tell not yet overdeveloped country and say, follow us. I said, that's wrong way. Boundary conditions change. Earth is not infinite anymore. It's finite. We are overloading it and really deteriorating. And if you think carefully, although Earth looks beautiful, but what we are living is really in a very thin skin. And Murayama-san showed a picture and said, only the skin of the peach, what we are living in on the Earth, in the atmosphere, hydrosphere, geosphere, biosphere, it's a very thin layer of maybe 40, 50 kilometers. That's all. And we are living in this very thin layer. The relation between sun and the earth is playing most important role. And we mess up the rain we are living, then our survival will be the problem. So let me first look at the relation between sun and surface temperature. Well, sun is hot, 5,000 degrees. It's irradiated, 5,000 degrees C, irradiated mostly in the visible UV region. And atmospheric compound, oxygen, nitrogen, even carbon dioxide will not absorb visible photon. It will come in with the average of 340 watt per square kilometer. The energy coming down will be reflected by the cloud. Some will be absorbed, but not as much. And down to the surface, it will be absorbed, reflected. Cloud will reflect some. Earth's temperature is relatively low, like we are seeing now. It emits infrared. Infrared photon will be absorbed by so-called greenhouse gases, like carbon dioxide, methane, freon, and so on. If we increase the greenhouse gases, the energy emitted from the surface is absorbed by greenhouse gases will emit it down. So the concentration of the greenhouse gases keep increasing, then the surface temperature will go up. For the last 20,000 years, carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is about 280 ppm. It was nice. Keep the surface of the Earth quite nice. If there are no greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, the surface temperature will be down to about minus 15 degrees centigrade. And as the carbon dioxide starts to increase, then the surface temperature will start to go up. So let us look at what we're seeing. This is the observation of carbon dioxide year after year. The peak is winter, the valley is the summertime. Photosynthesis becomes stronger. The blue light is the measurement down in South Pole. Red light is in Mauna Loa in Hawaii. So you see, from 1980, carbon dioxide keep on going up. So this is what we see in Mauna Loa. 205 has gone through. We have reached 400. Actually, now it's beyond 102, went up this high. And if I squeeze the time and look at time backward, you can see that this time will go down to 280, and you trace time back and back, then you will see that the pre-industrial level is about 278, 280. Then you look at the ancient times, there's a ice age, and you do see some oscillations. That oscillation is mainly because Earth moving around the moon is not circular orbit, and axis of the Earth's rotation also make an axis with the axis of the orbit. So we do see that oscillations, but carbon dioxide concentration was below 280, the peak we created is really due to the peak we created, the sharp rise is really due to human activities. And I do not believe there's any scientist working on the atmosphere believe that something happened just occasionally. That's not true. What we are observing in the rise of the temperature is strongly correlated, and that it's a sharp spike going up. at the present time. These are very important consequences. So I said, we are overloaded. Earth system is overloaded with human being, not only the population, because of consumption. We are sinking very quickly. So just pay attention to this. It's rise. It's rising quickly. We are bringing this one up at the rate of 2 parts per million a year. And if you carry out the calculation, temperature will rise when the concentration went up to go up to about 400 ppm. Then 25 years from now, if we do not try hard, business as usual, 25 years, temperature will rise to 2 degrees centigrade. It's not a very good thing. So this is the temperature as a function of time. It's going up. Well, of course, sometimes doesn't seem to be going up as fast. It's flat, going up, seems to be flat. And lots of scientists in the past thought that the global warming is really not as expected by scientists. But recent measurement shows that when this global temperature is relatively flat, energy is really going to the ocean because ocean flow affects the energy, ocean temperature is rising. So total amount of energy absorbed and global temperature rise is really very well understood now. Here, 2015, you see 2050 is here, 2015 is somewhere around here. 2015. If we do not try hard, the curve will keep on going up by the end of the century, temperature will be rising to 4 to 5 degrees centigrade. If COP21 turned out to be successful, and if we carry out the deep decarbonization, then it is possible to maintain the temperature rise to within 2 degrees or before industrial revolution. So that's the curve we try to reach. Actually, this curve, if we were to start 20, 30 years ago, then it could be lower. But we failed to do so and go up here. And if we try very hard, it will be 2 degrees centigrade. So everybody said 2 degrees centigrade and don't let the temperature rise beyond 2 degrees centigrade. But I have to tell you, 2 degrees centigrade is pretty bad. But we cannot do any better. We, means the old generation of scientists, cannot do better. Maybe young students sitting there might have different ideas. You might challenge and say, why United Nations said population go up to 9.7 instead 8.2? Why can we control the population? Why every country said we are going to have a sustainable development, or said energy requirement will maintain the same and find the renewable energy? So the way people are thinking is still very traditional. And of course, you want to cool it down and the earth cool down, we have to do something drastic. Population has to be controlled, consumption has to be controlled, but that's not the way we will be able to do it at the present time. Things are moving with a certain momentum. So that's what I'm saying. We're trying very hard not to let temperature go up to 4 or 5 degrees, instead go up to 2 degrees from pre-industrial revolution era. What is the consequences? If you look at this famous picture provided by IPCC, it's called burning amber. If you look at this picture, if the color is white, it means it's okay. It will be a wonderful climate. On the other hand, when turn become yellow and orange and red, it will be red and turn to purple, it will be worse, it will be very bad. In 2001, when IPCC first presented this scientific prediction of what could happen, picture wasn't as bad. And that was part of the reason we keep on talking about 2 degrees centigrade. At that time, when you look at 2 degrees centigrade, this is white color all the way up. By 2007, IPCC come up with second report and say, things are worse than what people has been expected. It become orange and red at much lower temperature. And this is the one they come up with, AR5, last year. Situation looks quite bad, pretty bad. If you look at the present time, so-called 0 degree mean temperature between 1986 to 2005, and if you take the average temperature before pre-industrial revolution, it's here. At the present time, if you look at the unique threatened system, it's starting to get into trouble. Extreme weather events also, as you see that there are lots of extreme weather events is happening. If you look at the distribution impact, start to go into an orange color, but global aggregate impact and large scale singular events is still, we don't worry about suddenly something happen and Earth system will be unmanageable. You don't have to worry about this. But 2 degrees will be up here. And look at this. If you look at the extreme weather events, it's already red color when temperature rises by 2 degrees centigrade, and distribution impact and even the large scale singular event in 2001, it is a white color, it is orange color. And if I try to convince the people that, yes, we are trying very hard to keep the Earth system wonderful for the next generation, I say, I'm sorry. We are trying to get the Earth system not as bad as showing up here, 4.5 degrees. Then you can see large-scale singular event is already in red color. Extreme weather event is all unbearable. So I cannot imagine when the global temperature rise to 4 or 5 degrees, whether we can survive. If you look at the Earth as a life system, like a human body, we maintain 36.5 degrees. When temperature rises by 2 degrees, 38.5, you said, teacher, I cannot walk today. I'll take leave of absence and stay home. If you go up to 4 degrees, medical doctor said, your life will be threatened. Probably will put you in the ice water or cool water, try to cool your body down. I think Earth's system, when it deteriorate, we are not saving Earth. Earth will be there, it's in different state. But humanity is the one which may be gone away. So let me just look at the one thing. First, extreme weather events, and see what's happening at the present time. We are right here. I want to show a couple pictures. That's the picture of when Morocco typhoon came. Morocco typhoon came to Taiwan. That was on August 8th. I remember very well. International Science Council. Couple visitors came to Taiwan and tried to see how are we prepared for the extreme weather events. They're very impressed by what we're doing. Then by lunchtime on August 8th, it's 2:07, they all left, but typhoon came in and stayed in southern part of Taiwan, and in 2 days, drop 2 meters of rain. Can you imagine? 2 meters of rain in 2 days, and you see Shaolin Village transform from this to this. Landslide took place, and first side on the left-hand side, and Tyson go down. 800 people killed overnight, just because the intense raindrop. Earlier in the century, typhoon came to Taiwan, Taipei. There, in 3 days, dropped 2 meters of rain, and Taipei's all flooded. Subway system, all the buildings are flooded. Now, if you look at another picture, those people from Philippines. Are you from, I think we have somebody from Philippines, must be remembered very well. Typhoon Haiyan, when it's landed, the wind speed is about 300 kilometers per hour. That is about 100 meters per second. If you look at the Olympic 100 meter dash, somebody can run 8.9 seconds, it's fast. But this wind, when it's landed, is about 100 meters per second. And one sweep, 70,000 people killed, passed away. And of course, that extreme weather event, people in the poor country or less developed part of the world will suffer disproportionately high. Aside from this, we are losing biodiversity fast. For example, bee, butterfly, and recently US government decided to breed the bee in the national forest. But we have 1/3 of the food we eat is pollinated by wild insects, worth over $200 billion. So when bee disappear and fruit production will go down, it is happening in many parts of the world now. Of course, when you take a piece of bread and you look at carefully, 1/3 of the bread is really coming from fossil fuel. In terms of fertilizer, you do not use the fertilizer, it will be lower. And the difference of those 30% is really coming from the fertilizer. We are eating the fossil fuel. We don't know it, but those energy really coming from fossil fuel. So global warming will hit us very hard. If we lose the biodiversity, we have a very hard time surviving, and we are going to have a food shortage. And the other thing in Asia is air pollution. Air pollution. It is really horrible to see that in major city in Asia, we always see a scenery like this. I think this picture is picture in Beijing. Some time ago, once I was visiting, my friend was really dismayed by low air quality. His staff said, "Professor Lee, I'm sorry, we could not have a sunny day to welcome you." And my friend said, "You're joking. Today is a sunny day. Wonderful day is we produce lots of pollutants, so we cannot see sunshine." In many parts of Asia, poor people or common people are asking the question, we develop and seem to be having some money in the pocket, but what we change for is the pollution. So many parts of the Asia, if we talk about global warming, they might not pay as much attention, but when we talk about air pollution threatening the health of the people, then many more people are willing to move. So actually, China tried to let carbon dioxide peak at 2030, but probably will peak earlier. The main reason is try to improve the air quality. The burning of the coal has to go down drastically. So those are the things. What we are saying is we live in a thin layer. We are changing it, and so we will have difficulty surviving. So I would conclude the future of humanity is at risk. Typhoon will become bigger, more powerful. We might go into the food shortage and shortage of water. the situation will be worse. And not that we are not trying, everybody trying, but we are trying to make it not as bad. But things will still be pretty bad unless we do something more drastically than what UN is suggesting. That's the scenario, that's the picture you're facing. So I've been working very hard during the last 7 years, but somewhat disappointed that we are not moving as fast. This year, we might see things move. And part of the reason is you go to the US, California is dropped, Texas is flat, and many people feel that they, if we don't do something, really going to suffer. So what should we do? What should we do? What I'm suggesting is lots of people understand that that might be something we should do, but it might not be moving as fast as we really want to see. First thing is, if you look at the pathway to global sustainability, these are global responses to global problems. Those are global problems. Also, deep decarbonization, every country is asked to do something, but if one country can do it, that's really not the solution. You have to come up with a global solution. So if the United States says, yes, I can bring it down by 2070, no carbon emission, but if other countries still emitting, that's really not the solution. But as we know, at the present time, our global organization is a nation state based. It's a United Nations. It's really nation state based. So you can arouse lots of emotion in the soccer game and always arouse lots of emotions and for your country. But the question is, can global problems be effectively solved by nation-based system and approaches? I have a big question. Because in 2003, in Rio Plus 20 meeting, nation states suggested many wonderful solutions, but if one of the nations disagreed and pull it out, in the end, it's really not anything substantial. We need to have a high organization. If we start to transfer funds from overdeveloped country to underdeveloped country, or we start to have a global carbon tax and start to have a global organization, see to it that the global problem will be solved globally. And I was saying, 50 years from now, maybe we don't have a passport anymore. Everybody has a card and said, I came from Republic of Mother Earth, or we came from the Republic of Earth system or something like this, and everybody tried to help each other. Unless we accomplish that, nation state based competition will go on and on. We want to try to reduce carbon dioxide, yet compete in the global market, and how can we corner the market, depend on technology, there will not be solution. So this is one thing that the young generation should think about. As I said, you're the first generation equipped to globally connected. We didn't have the equipment to do so. You could be globally connected and try to promote global organization pass beyond United Nations. This is one thing which is very important. The reason is very simple. If you look at how much more carbon dioxide you can put into the air before it reach 2 degrees centigrade? About 100 billion tons. How much carbon dioxide we are putting in the air every year? At the present time, we are releasing about 40 billion tons. 1,000 divided by 40, everybody know how to count, except the congressman in the US might not be able to do it. That's 25, right? So when we said we are increasing carbon dioxide, 2 parts per million, from 400 to 450. Again, 25 years. So if we do not do anything, 25 years we reach 2 degrees centigrade, and that will be 2040, not after the middle century yet. And then it will keep on going up. So no matter whether you release carbon dioxide in Taiwan or China, India, United States, it will be spread all over the world. So we have to care about how much total carbon dioxide is emitted. The second thing is, if I trace the history and said 200-300 years ago, we are part of nature. Sunshine brought us here. We depend on the sun. Then, after the Industrial Revolution, we depart from, dissociate from the nature, dissociate from sunshine. Many youngsters living, born in the city, living in the city, certainly do not understand how rich the nature is and how much nature is providing us. So we, in a sense, we have to go back to sunshine. We have to go back to nature since we departed. And when I said back to nature, back to sunshine, many of the young students think, no way, I'm not going to live in a very primitive life. Well, not at all. Going back to nature, it's really very powerful. And when I say go back to sunshine, when we talk about deep decarbonization, we want to eliminate burning of fossil fuel. We said we should have a fusion reactor developed. We have a fusion reactor. The physics happening inside the sun was very clearly presented yesterday by Professor Murayama. We have fusion reactor, and fusion reactor has to be far away. So we do have one very far away, and that fusion reactor is transmitting energy to the surface of the Earth. In 1 hour, the total amount of energy transmitted is equivalent to the energy we use in the human society for about 1 year. But during the last 150 years, we found fossil fuel, so we just neglected the energy coming from the sun. I'm sure in the next 20, 30 years, we'll develop enough technology to be able to use sunshine more effectively. Let me take an example, a solar panel. It will cost more than $70 to produce 1 watt of electricity in 1977. So maybe you remember 77, it's about $77. Now it's went down and down. In 2013, it's about 70 cents. Today, in 2050, maybe about 50 cents, the price will go down. And within 10 years, electricity generated by solar panel or other thermal devices would be less expensive than burning fossil fuel, including the fossil fuel coming from fracking. The price will go down. But what we need to do is to learn, develop the technology so the electricity could be stored or transformed to distribute in the global market. But go back to sunshine or wind power, all coming from the sun, whether wind power or solar energy, all come from the sun. And we will be able to depend on the energy coming from the sun. The one difference is the following. Place like the United States, my former student in San Diego, she has a big house with a photovoltaic cell, covered the entire roof. And last time when we visited, Kim Plaza said, Professor Lee, I don't buy electricity anymore. My solar panel produce enough energy for my family use and also charge up CSI electric car called Nissan Leaf. So my car is also powered by Nissan Leaf. And she said, I am a clean person now. I'm clean. And look at me and say, Professor Lee, can you do it in Taiwan? I said, well, I will tell you one thing. First, population density in Taiwan is 640 per square kilometer. And population density in the United States is 30. And American is 21 times more photons coming in per capita. So I said, if I look at the roof in our apartment complex, I can only get a small roof per capita. Not like you, get a big house and a big roof. So different place will have different problems. But it's interesting, government in Taiwan always tried to learn from the United States. So when US said, two-thirds of energy will come from the sun, one-third of energy comes from the wind, we also say, or government also said, two-thirds of the energy will come from the sun, one-third from the wind. But we have 21 times more population in the island. The solution will be different. And unless we distribute energy more effectively across the national boundary, we will not find solution. The third thing is, we want to live better for less. I think when I talk about this, I keep on remembering your Honorable King said, sufficient economy. We don't use too much, only sufficient. Of course, sufficient is different, depending on how society is organized. So as I was saying, that we want to have enough energy, but the energy is 2 kilowatt per person or 10 kilowatt per person. It depends on how the society organized, whether you can go to work. And if you design a city for the automobile, earlier in the year I was in Houston, and I saw the youngster who went to graduate school in Taiwan. Everybody is having a car. I said, Professor Lee, in Houston, if you don't have a car, I cannot go to school, cannot do shopping, and this is the necessity. It's the fundamental need is to have a car. The city is designed for the automobile spread all over the place. On the other hand, last month I was in Prague. I worked for about 6 hours in the day, reached every part of the city, old town, new town, lesser town, and that was the city designed before the automobile. Now you see lots of automobiles. Do you know what this is for? This automobile is not waiting to be sold. This is already out of style and sitting somewhere waiting to be destroyed. Those are the automobiles waiting to be destroyed. So if we try to help the not yet developed country in Africa and said, build a freeway, everybody should own automobile, or every 3 person or 5 person own an automobile, that would not be allowing us to develop sustainably. Of course, if you design a city, most of the things you can do it within walking distance. You don't depend on the automobile, you can bicycle in walking distance, and whether rich people or poor people all live in the same village, then things will be different. The next thing is the control population explosion. One day I was making a trip to Paris to my headquarters for International Council of Science. There's a business lady sitting next to me and said, Professor Lee, you seem to be worried. Why are you worrying? So I said, I'm going to the meeting in Paris in International Council of Science. We'll be discussing a program called Future Earth, mainly try to tackle global warming problem. So she said, What is causing that? I say we have too many people consuming too much resources, and Earth is finite. We are changing our Earth from infinite system to finite system. So all the way the things we are doing is no longer applicable. We have to change. So she looked at me and said, Professor Lee, are you working to reduce the population? I said, no. Are you working to reduce the consumption? I said, no. We try to get scientists to work on the Earth systems and clean energy, renewable energy. And the businessman looked at me and said, Professor Lee, I don't understand. You said there are two problems, and you're not working on this. And what you're working on certainly will not have major effect, isn't it? She was very clear in mind, businessman, that sometimes thinking very straight. And I feel sorry that day. What we are doing is not what needs to be done. So if you look at the Sustainable Development Goal, 17 Sustainable Development Goals written, none of them are really challenging the population problem. Some of the audience might say, yes, population could be controlled if we pay attention to the education. If we educate people well, especially the education of girls, and that's something I didn't accept in the early days, as when you said education of girls, I always feel that they went on boys. And they say, you see, you educate a boy, you only educate one person. You educate a girl, you educate entire family. And also, if the girls decide when to have a baby, have a family planning, and production of next generation will be quality-based, not quantity-based, and you educate them well, have health insurance or some social network system, then population could be controlled. So of course, when I said transfer $100 billion from developed country to developing country, then somebody will ask, is a large fraction of this money will be spent in the education of girls in Africa or South Asia, then population might really come down or not go up. And it makes a tremendous difference from 7.3 to 9.7 or 8.5, more than 10, 20% of difference. That will be a very important factor. So if you see that those are very typical in Asia, densely populated place in summertime. This is the time you go to the sea and swim in it. You cannot imagine whether you'll be enjoying this scenario, but I think if your neighbor go to the seaside and swim, your children will say, Mom, we want to go to the seashore, to the seaside to swim. When at the University of Chicago, when my son was in the kindergarten, she came back one day and said, Dad, when are we going to Switzerland to ski? I said, what are you saying? He was attending University of Chicago Laboratory School. Most of the kids there are rich people, except the children of the faculty of the University of Chicago. So he looked at me and said, when are we going to Switzerland for skiing? I said, what are you saying? He said, who my classmates going to Switzerland for skiing? I said, no, we are not going to Switzerland for skiing. So next day, I moved him out and sent him to the public school. And put to the public school. It's a very rough public school. About 50% of the students are coming from slum. But he did survive. He did learn to survive and grow up very well. And that's an interesting thing. So control population explosion, that is something not tackled very well by developed country. It's interesting. You go to France. Many years ago, they tried to encourage produce more baby. You come to Taiwan, government will do a lot. If you produce a baby, will help. And try to continue the baby boom. I think same in Japan. population started to go down. Korea, actually Taiwan is the place population going down fast. Of course, if I think if the population from 23 million people go down to half by 2050, Taiwan will be a much better place. Of course, we have to suffer. Government say we will not have enough soldiers to fight. We don't have enough manpower to compete in the industrial production. But globally speaking, population needs to be controlled. And the other thing is the what I'm saying is improve equality around the world. This is a photo from one of the big cities in the world. Anybody know where it is? Is that Bangkok? It doesn't look like. Kuala Lumpur, Taipei, or China, Beijing, Shanghai. This is the Rio. Oh no, it's in Brazil. In Brazil. It's interesting. We always said, yes, we have to help the poor people to improve. So Millennium Development Goal said we'll reduce the poor people income less than $1.5 a day to how many percent. People always try to do this, but never talk about how can we reduce the very rich people. And Piketty, a French economist, said last year, if the capital gain of some of the rich people, capital gain, is higher than the growth of the economy, then other part of the people will become poorer. So disparity between rich and poor will increase. So on one hand, we said we want to help poor out of poverty. So Millennium Development Goal, people are quite happy and said, poor people, the number has been reduced, but rich people increased immensely. And disparity between rich and poor is increased. So we do have the challenge. And if we work on the equity, the justice, then people will not dream that we are going to live like this. But many people came from developed country. When you talk about sustainable development, that development always justified what happened in their society and said, we want to help. I said, no, we really have to develop society very differently since we are already overloaded. And government should not allow anybody to live like this. Every apartment is a swimming pool. Can you imagine? Of course, if there's a drought, there's no water. I like to play tennis, but I don't think I need to have so many tennis in an apartment complex. We really need to share. And so we said there are many important things we have to do it and come back to it. Unless we control the population, control the consumption, it's not likely that we'll be able to reach the goal. So now, we come back to the Earth. After 65 minutes, we return to the Earth. And that Earth, older generation handed to you, it's not in good shape, moving in the wrong direction. And the older generation certainly has responsibility to make it better. But what we are doing is not trying to make it miserable, try to make it not as bad, but still what we are trying is going to be an Earth system which is worse, no worse than when we are here today. So I mentioned yesterday, my wife could not understand. She thought, I work for the organization. The mission is promoting international science for the benefit of society. And you work so hard. And then I tell her, the consequences of my working hard, it's not going to get this place better. It's getting worse. I just prevent looking very, very bad. So she could not understand. She said, our grandchildren will not have a better environment. I said, no, no way. If we can survive for the next 40, 50 years, and then when young people take over, change all the rules, and then Earth might cool down. But for the next 20, 30 years, I do not believe we can do it. But COP21 is the final chance that we might not get the Earth system out of control. So you will have a chance during the miserable time to find a new pathway. So I want to summarize. So today, politically speaking, this is a global problem in need of global solutions. So why we take such an effort to bring all of you from Asian country, you make friends, get connected, come up with a global solution, have to have a global government, and that will replace the current citizenship of country into the citizenship of planet of Earth, and that step is important. Earlier this year in India, in one of the Sustainable Development Summit, when I was saying that we need to change ourselves into the citizenship of planet of Earth, the minister from France, a minister of environment from France, came and said, Professor Lee, I agree with you, but we might start with accepting everybody is a citizen of your country. At the same time, you have to create the citizen of Mother Nature, and then we'll make the second more and more important, so we'll be in a family. The second thing is socially, we must turn away from the past of the overdeveloped societies. I remember 30 years ago, when I was in China, discussing with the leaders of Chinese society, they decided to start the automobile industry, and they said, look, you look at the United States, the development of the United States in the 20th century, all headed by automobile industry and petroleum industry. I said, but in a place so densely populated, that would not be an ideal solution. I think in Bangkok also, I think in Paris, public transportation is excellent, but in ICSU, International Council of Science, almost everybody live outside. Inside is too expensive. Live outside, and it takes hours and hours in and out, like what you are doing. I feel very sorry that you have been accompanying me, most of you, and spent hours and hours spending on it. So we should not accept the way society has developed. Depends so much on the automobile. We could make a society very differently. Maybe a city designed for the people, not for the automobile. And you can walk and ride a bicycle to do many things. Well, many of you are interested in science, aspire to be scientists. Of course, there are many things you can do. Taking care of cancer or disease, and on the energy aspect, I would say in the next 5-10 years, there will not be a problem of converting sunshine into electricity efficiently. But we still need to develop the technology, store the energy, or split the energy, so we'll ship across the national boundary. And this is very important. Unless we learn to do this and solve the energy problem globally will not solve the problem. Actually, in the turn of the century, a very famous Japanese scientist, Nishikawa Junichiro, he was the president of Tokyo University and became president of Torii University. He wrote a book and said, humanity will extinguish in 80 years. In 80 years, we have gone through 15 years, so 65 years left. And the reason he wrote that book was he started to understand the problem of global warming and what could be affecting us. Have you read the book? No, it's a wonderful book. And Nishikawa Junichiro-san is very interesting. Every time we have a chance to talk to him, he will look at the entire Earth system and he will say that, well, we need to have a high voltage DC transmission line. We harvest solar energies and can make the high voltage transmission line to globally connected. And for the wind power generation, you come near the polar region, wind is steady, so we should have brought a wind power generator, again connected to DC high voltage transmission line. And he often think Earth as a unit and try to come up with technology. And he was working on a transistor, yes, a chopper, make DC into AC. And he knew that if we transmit AC, DC, when you send to home, and you start to use, change it to AC to drive the motors and do other things, the frequency might not be 60 cycle, might be 400 hertz, might be smaller motor, but the transmission will not be lost because we are transmitting DC. We need more people like him and really taking care of the Earth system. I was the president of International Council of Science, so I thought I'm in the position to do the things like that, but not moving very, very well, or moving very much. So that's the challenge. That's the challenge. This Earth is head in the wrong direction. Earth system is deteriorating. Older generation is trying, but what we are doing will not be enough. We should do more. We might have to have very different philosophy. So that's the challenge. Coming to Asian Science Camp, you bring back and say, Professor Lee said, we will be miserable unless we do something, and that will be true. So I'm sorry, my story will not be beautiful and said glorious, and stand here and said, well, Asia will lead the world. We will lead the world. If we transform and find a new way to develop the society, then we will lead the world. If we follow the path which has been taking place, then we will not be able to lead the world. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Lee, for a wonderful lecture and for an important reminder to us all. So at this moment, let's turn to one of the moments that define Asian Science Camp. Questions from students. Reset again. 1, 2, 3. That's all you.
Thank you. Hello, my name is Hien Su. I'm from Cambodia, and I have a question that, as we know, from day to day, our planet is getting hot, and the CO2 and methane is, well, it's giving the heat to the planet. And though without the CO2 emission, what will happen to our planet?
I didn't quite get your question. You put the microphone closer and
yes.
Keep it steady.
Our planet is getting hotter, and we know that CO2 emission and methane giving a hit to our planet. And what we do if it, without CO2 emission, what will happen to our Earth?
Well,
yes, if no CO2 emission.
if humidity does not produce CO2,
yes,
the earth system, with the rain, the forest and a lot of biological activities, will maintain the CO2 concentration to the certain level. And it used to be around 280 ppm. So when we say go down to zero emission, probably we'll go back to about 280 ppm. If we keep on deforestation, and then the capability of sunshine to put carbon dioxide into the earth system, into the forest and into the wood, that activity will be lower. So if we do not emit the carbon dioxide, we will still have a certain level of carbon dioxide and keep us warm.
So we still need CO2 again. We still need CO2 to support our Earth getting warm?
Yeah.
Oh. And one more question. Who is the responsible for the CO2 emission, like scientists or government?
I think we have to ask everybody to help. It is interesting. Every country and many organizations said, we are green organization, so try to recycle and do certain things. But if we ask how much CO2 emission should be reduced, they say, I don't know. But if we commit everybody, every country, everywhere to have a deep decarbonization, then starting with the country level, the country will say, okay, like Taiwan is emitting 11 tons per capita. It's very high. So if you bring it down to something like 1.5 tons, 1.7 tons, then we have to decide what would be the most effective way to do. If government said, okay, if you let the population slide down, by 2050, population will become one half of what we have now, then everybody consume one half of the resources, then it will already cut down to 25%. So depending on what you do, we have to tell young people that we have to learn to live a simple life. And many young people say, no way, no way. Don't ask me to live a simple life. You guys should do it first. But there will be lots of argument, but everybody has to be involved. Government should have a policy, encourage the investment toward the deep decarbonization process, even for the energy sector, or the use of the energy more efficiently. Everybody should do it.
Oh, it's everyone. Thank you, Mr. Reset.
Reset. 1, 2, 3.
Wow.
Introduce yourself first.
I'm Soyeon Lee from South Korea. Thank you for your wonderful lecture, Professor. You said that politically, to solve global problem, we need global approaches and global solutions. But in most cases, developing countries feel that they should be given the chance to develop as developed countries.
Yeah.
And also, developed countries believe that they fail to compromise with developing countries. So most of the times, global solutions are not made in such meetings. So how can we make them prioritize these global problems over national interests so that there can be actual concrete alternatives and solutions to make a better future? Thank you.
That's a very good question. You see, when I talk to people in Africa, when I said the entire system is overdeveloped, they always said, Professor Lee, don't say that. We don't like to hear that. We say we are miserable, we need to develop. I say, yes, you certainly need to develop. But the question is, how they should develop? If major industry will come in and corrupt the government and say, try to do this, try to do that for their interest, then the developing country will follow the forces of current conglomerate or industry and not move into the right direction. So when we said you have the right to develop, you need to develop, the question is how? How are they going to develop? Not to follow the footsteps of the United States is for sure. But developed country, by overloading the earth, and if per capita emission was 20 tons, and that causing global warming problem, they should feel guilty. They should feel guilty. If overdeveloped country always feel that that's the way society develops, then I think very difficult. Even in the international council science, we try to balance the regional representatives, but still the thinking are Eurocentric thinking. So when we, many of the representative mix who go down to South Africa or go to Latin America, people always not feel as comfortable about the way they are thinking. So developed country has to accede to the fact the way their society develops is not the way developing countries should follow. So, for example, in your country, in Korea, they tried to set up the Green Fund to make it available to globally. It's not going down very well, but many organizations try to set up some global activities. If we come up with an agreement about global carbon tax and more activity, for example, transfer of 100 billion from developed country to developing country, you again need to have an organization. If that organization still depends on the United Nations, unless the United Nations change, it will be difficult. So I think you have the responsibility to get organized, get people organized. So look, you look at your left and right and friends coming from different countries. You should learn to work together to give us hope.
Reset. One, two, three.
Good morning, Professor Lee. I'm Yue Qian from Malaysia. I have a question regarding the sustainability model. As we know, resources on Earth are finite. However, the traditional and mainstream concept in economy is to pursue growth. But since the resources are not unlimited, so is the economic growth. And seeing many countries are not cooperative enough in submitting their INDCs due to various reasons, and I just check up that, in fact, only 22 countries have submitted their INDCs. I assume that their reasons for such delay is mainly for development of their economy. So I would like to know, as a scientist, how do you see the likelihood of the transition of the economy model, or rather, we say the balancing point between development and turning to sustainable development. Thank you.
I think if you look at the atomic system and look at the electron moving around the nuclei, electron can move in the free space whatever energy you want. But if, because of the wave property, when the electron is moving around, for example, hydrogen moving around proton, when it's localized, energy level will be quantized. So the boundary condition will determine the energy level. If you make the system big, then energy level will be continuous. What I'm trying to say is the boundary condition of human society living on Earth has changed. The Earth system used to be almost infinity. So when we talk about development, you cut down the tree and go into the agriculture, build the building, and you embed it into nature. And economic development, always production, consumption, then you compete in the global market. So if you go home, pay attention to your government policy. We want you to be a good scientist so you can contribute to the national competitiveness. Always compete, otherwise we'll not survive. So one thing, as I said, boundary condition has changed. So all the economists said, economy will not develop unless you keep on expanding the economic scale or keep on producing it, consuming it. So everybody look at market opportunities. Where is the market you can sell things and so you can produce more? But that picture is fine when Earth is infinity, but Earth is finite. So we have to change all the system. So I don't know any of you want to be an economist in the future. Hey, you will be economist. You have a good opportunity because what people have been saying, what your teacher has been saying, and all the books written by economists, very often assuming the system is infinity. When I went to California, higher education was free in 1962. California government said, well, don't you come? Come and stay. California need to develop, and Southern California developing. That's not going to happen, and that is the wrong way. So we have to come up with an economy. Everybody will live well with a small consumption of resources, and you can live better. And what kind of economy would that be? I think I'll let us figure it out. Everybody will see that this is the opportunity for us to change. Economy has to change. So if your government said the economy is not going well, and ask people to consume. I said, seems to be moving in the wrong way. So I cannot give you an answer. Try to find the answer yourself. And tell your professor, I say, professor, you're wrong. I have a new economic theory for the future.
We're running out of time. So if you have more questions, feel free to ask Professor Lee afterward. So apologize for that.
Well,
so
I would say if you have a question, you ask yourself and try the answer. And then you give me the answer. You give me the answer, I correct it. And then I said there are many good suggestions. I will not provide any more answers. The more I talk, you have more questions. That's a good thing. But I will not be able to answer all the questions.
Please give a big hand to Professor Lee. Okay?
Thank you. My plea is don't corner me and ask me many, many questions, but try to answer the question yourself and give me some answers.
Thank you, Professor, for the really good panel, for the good plenary. So we're gonna give about 15 minute breaks. We have some snack provided outside of the room. And please come back by 10:15 so we can start panel discussion by that time. Thank you.
No, I don't understand you. Okay.
You pick. I pick. Yeah, you pick. I